Hi YouTube, this is AAA X-Ray coming back to you with a new video. I know it has been a while, I've been quite busy and I've not been able to play so much, neither did I have time to make videos. But now I have some time and I already wanted to make this video for a long time. So here I have three boxes and they are the three scenario games in the Axis and Allies franchise. So they are different from the other games, because the other games more or less play a global scenario, or at least play like half a global scenario. But these three games, they are only one battlefield. So for example, this is the Normandy landings, D-Day called. So this game was released in 2004, and so it's quite old already, and but it's quite easy to get. So if you want to have it on second-hand sites, you'll probably be able to find it if you have some patience. So it's quite easy to get, and here in Europe you should get it for around 30 euro. So then you would get this game. So later in 2006, the second scenario game was released. That was the Battle of the Bulge, which plays in the Ardennes in 1944. And actually this game is much harder to find, and prices go up easily to about 80 euro. Now the third one, and that's what I actually want to make a video about today, is Axis and Allies Guadalcanal. And this game is very rare. And I've been very lucky. A friend of mine also make YouTube videos. Bought two in the past, and he was willing to sell me one for a very friendly price. But if you get it on the second-hand websites, the price for this game easily go up to about 300 euros. So I got this from my friend Dutch Orange Triangle. So also check out his channel. He did not make too much videos, but it's interesting anyway. Hope he'll make more in the future. And the nice thing about this game, it's still completely sealed. So what I want to do is I want to open it together with you, so that you can have a view what's inside. So as you saw, I unpack everything and put the loose parts in the box, and let's have a check what we find inside. So the most special thing about this version, in my opinion, is the way you throw dice. It uses this device, which is a box, and the way it works is all the dice are in this box, and you have to shake it. And then you pull it like this, and then the amount of hits you're going to have, maybe you're going to have five hits, so you have to read the first five positions, and you have to interpret it which kind of hit that is. So that is yeah, much different from all the other games where you throw the oh, there's one die stuck. So. Oh. Probably have to get used to it a bit. But anyway, so this is yeah, that's much different from all the other games where you just throw all the dice in a box and read the numbers. Well, the units, they are just the green units for the United States and the orange units for Japan. So later we'll look in more detail how the miniatures look like. This also don't need to explain, it's just the regular. So we have a nice manual, and of course this is all new, so it looks very good. Manual. Then there's two cards, and they are for each player, and they yeah, they give some key information about the game, like the sequence, what are the different units, what are the attack values, etc. So it's a nice hard cardboard, it's quite big. So that one was for the United States, this one is for Japan. Then these are the game aids. You see extra boards for Japan and the United States, and also different things like resources, airfields, some markers, etc. And then here is the battle board. So as you see, this is the scenario. This is a very small place in the Pacific called the Solomon Islands, and here is where the battle was fought. Yeah, so I think what would be nice is to set it up one time and check some more detail. So I set up the game. One thing I did not do correct, that is actually this card. Need to be here, but because that's outside of the video, I put it here. Same for Japan, also need to be on the other side. So of course I wanted to give you a good overview, so I put it in. Also the other one thing is I put all the sculpts here, so that you can have an overview, and of course I will zoom in. So what I see with the sculpts is basically they are all the familiar sculpts that we know of the other games in the franchise. Actually in this game there's one mistake, and it is about the cruiser. So actually the sculpt for the US cruiser is a Japanese ship, and the other way around, this cruiser is a US ship. So if this is bothering you, probably you can fix this with pieces from other games, And if not, then they'll do perfectly. Another thing is the anti-air. So this is the anti-air, and this is the sculpt is as we know it from the old games, but there they were in a universal color, either white or gray, but here they are in a specific color of the country. So this is a Japanese, and this is the US AA gun. So actually they are same. So in later games they changed it, and they gave every country their own specific AA gun, referring to an actual model of AA guns in use at that time. So another difference from the regular games is the fighter, and this fighter I think is also in use in one of the other games on the franchise, but it is an carrier-based fighter, and actually in the book it doesn't mention which model it is, but I guess it's an F4F Wildcat. Yeah, in general the game looks very nice. There's some other things, like there are air bases. The air base looks like this. You can swap them. This way it's a damaged air base. This way it's a regular air base. And air bases are very important in this game, because you have to count points, and that is based on how much air bases you have in one turn. So if you have a certain number of air bases at the end of your turn, you will go up that many points. And of course then the one who reaches the 15 first is the one who wins. So both sides start with one airbase, and to build an airbase you need resources. Those are those things, or supplies, sorry, they are called supplies. And they also have a function, of course. Aircraft can land there, and actually aircraft cannot land just anywhere. They have to land on a carrier or on an airfield. So if the airbase is damaged and you don't have a carrier, then your aircraft will be lost. So yeah, that's an interesting mechanic. So as you can see, the game starts with Japan controlling most of the islands, except for here the island Guadalcanal, where the US have a strong presence. Actually, I forget to put on the Japanese forces, so I still have to do. This is a contested island. So I quickly corrected my mistakes. I put in here some Japanese infantry and some Japanese supplies. So my general impression is that also the amount of units is quite sufficient. I use everywhere the gray chips, and that is mainly to save space, because some of the piles, especially the planes, are quite high. You start here with five bombers and five fighters. Apart from the fighters that are already on the carriers. So, but I think actually there will be enough units to set up the game without using chips in the first place. So that is quite sufficient and nice. Yeah, I'm wondering how is the mechanics of this game, and I think I will look it up and read the manual a bit, and then come back to you. Okay, so I never played this game before, so I have this card and I have to look at it. I also have the manual close at hand. So there is three phases. I will put this here, maybe you can also read it. So there are three phases. One is the movement phase, One is the combat phase and one is the regroup phase. So this is still quite similar to the other games in the franchise. However, this works in a way that one player has the first player token, and the access start with this. And so every step will first be done by the first player and then by the second player. Then you go to the next step. Again, this is first done by the first player and then by the second player. Okay, so we will just do it and then you'll see how it works. So first step is load and move transports. So we move the Axis transports now. We will do the same now with the Allies transports. Okay, so we move all the transports now. Now we will move the battleships. After the battleship, we move the carriers. And now we move the cruisers. So now it's the turn of the destroyers. Okay, so the next thing we'll do is we move the submarines and we attack with the submarines. So at this moment, the Japanese have one submarine that can strike something, so he will attempt to do this so, and he will try to hit the carrier here. The other moves the Axis will do is just with this submarine go here. Okay, so we'll throw our first die. Okay, so we have to read it in this way. We have one sub, so we throw one die, and we read the first one here, and it's a 4, so that's a miss. Now the same thing will happen with the subs of the Allies. Okay, so this sub will do the same thing. He will try to hit the sub of the Axis. Again, have a 4. So the next thing will happen is that the bombers will fly. So Japan have 2 bombers. So we'll see where they can go. Okay, all Axis planes moved, so now we move the Allied planes. Okay, the Allies move the planes, and this will actually result in one combat here. And as far as I can see, there will be a combat here. So the way this happens is now first the air combat will happen. There's only one combat, so normally the first player will choose, but since there is will choose which combat will be done first, but in this case it doesn't matter, it's one combat. So this fighter will contribute to 2 die, this one two, and the bombers to one die. So this will be oh yeah, and sorry, there's one destroyer and one cruiser here, and they will also contribute to one dice. So there will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 dice for the Axis, and the same amount for the Allies. Let's see who is lucky here. Okay, so this is the roll for the Axis, and we count the first 8, that's the up till here. So then we see there's 2 hits, this one and this one. So this will cost the Allies 1 fighter and another fighter. So 2 fighters are lost for the Allies. So this is unlucky, I guess, for the Axis, because here we also count the first 8 dice, and here we have 2 hits, but one is on the bomber and another is also on the bomber. So Axis lose 2 bombers. Okay, so that's it for the air combat. Now we have sea combat, and so we have here a sea combat, and we have here a sea combat. So the Axis choose. So let's take this one, since I'm playing both, the Axis and the Allies, doesn't matter. We'll take this one and then we do this one. So here we have 2 fighters, and our fighters have an attack value on C for 1. So we have just two dice which we can play here. And both are misses. Since the Allies do not have ships here, so we don't have to throw dice for the Axis to see what hits the Allies take. Here both have ships, so let's first let's see. I guess the Axis don't have any attack value because they already did in their special movement phase. So we only do it for the Allied ships. So they have 3 ships. The aircraft carrier does not have any attack value, so it's only about the cruiser, who have a 2, and a destroyer, which have a 1. So we have 3 dice, which we have to count. So we have 2 hits, and that's on a destroyer and a cruiser. Because there is no Axis destroyer or cruiser, it goes to the first unit on this list, and that would be automatically a submarine. So the submarine is dead. Okay, so that was it for those combats. So this next thing will be done now is the unloading of the units. So first of all, the Axis will unload, and now the Allies will unload. And this will result in a couple of battles. Here, here, and here. So we'll fight them out. And again, here we need to count. So let's fight this battle first. And for the land battle, actually the battleship can join for 2. So he is joining with 2 dice here. Here we have an a cruiser, which can join this fight. Another cruiser can join this fight, and I guess that's an overkill for the amount of units that are here anyway, because there's only 3 units. So let's see here, excessive, he have an attack value of 9 here. It's up to here, and I think they're lucky because they have 1, 2, 3, 4 hits, so that means all units here are gone. And then we see how much damage do the Allies do. They have a 2, 4, 6, 7, 8. So it's also not too bad. They have also 4 hits, and that is And because the axes have more units here, we actually have to count it out who takes the hit. So we have one infantry, another infantry, artillery, and one anti-air gun that take the hits. So we actually have one anti-air gun, we have an artillery, and then we have two infantry. Those take the hits. And then also those are gone. Let's see how they do here. Here the allies have a great overkill, so they should have it easily. They have five bombers, which have a value of two. And then they still have two cruisers. So that is already enough for the first 12 hits. So let's see how much we get. Okay, and so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 hits, which is enough to kill all the Japanese on this island. So they are gone. So now this island is officially for the US. Here we have one other battle. There we have one Japanese. So we have a cannoli. Check the first die. And that's a 4 again, as regularly as a 4 can apparently. So no hit, and the allies have 2, 4, 6 hits. So, and they have 2 hits, so that's enough to kill this guy. Okay, so that were all the land battles. So now starts the regrouping phase. And at first of all, it has to be decided now who is controlling which island. So this one was controlled by the US, it's still controlled by the US. This one swapped sides now, so it's owned by the US now. And on the other islands, no changes because there is no allied unit present. So this island is controlled now by the Allies. There is two supplies from the Japanese, so they are now owned by the US. So I add them to this stack. So that's one. Then we have to land air units. Okay, so that is the landing of the Japanese planes. Now we have to do it with the Allies. Yeah, that's it for the planes. Then we build airfields. So I think I did not play smart for the axes because their supplies are spread out. I think it's smarter to make sure that at the end of this turn you had one place at least free supplies, which I did not really think about. So now that means they cannot build any airfield. Allies can, so for sure they will do. Cost them free supplies, so they will build it here. So because in this sequence you can build the airfield after you have to land the planes, no more planes can land here at this turn. So next thing we do is reinforce, and the way it works is every side get 5 points plus 2 points for every island that they control, those points you can spend like money. So Japan has 4 islands, so they have get 8 points for that, plus 5 is 13. So what they purchase is one supply token, one bomber, two transports, and artillery. Same for the Allies. So what they purchase is 2 supply tokens plus 2 transports and an infantry. So any unspent point is lost. So you better spend everything well. So now we check the score. And the score is for the US 2 points, because they possess 2 airfields, undamaged airfields. So that is a 2. And Japan 1. Yeah, this is the end of this first round. So first player token. We'll move to the other side now. So next time US can first select its moves. So yeah, it's quite interesting. I think it's an interesting mechanic. I made some mistakes here and there, especially because I'm playing here by myself. So then it's easy to make mistakes with the order of play. I guess when you're playing together, then this is will be more fluent. I think it's more a little bit more complex than the regular games, but I think it's still simple enough that you can play it. And I think this is also a game you can play in one evening and finish it and determine at least who is winning. So I enjoy it, and I hope to play my first game with this soon. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.